Belinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of Clementine, a fantasy novel written by Sophie Masson and read by Mikaela. For my dear ones of the beautiful Val d'Oise, with much affection, Gabrielle, Bruno, Gregoire, Camille, Gaspard. June 21, 1969. My dear Fiona, so you are in love. So you have, as you say, awakened into a beautiful dream. My dear child, I am so happy for you, so thrilled. I hope that the dream will always be as beautiful as it is now. Remember, my darling, when you used to question me about what you called the olden days? Remember how I used to say, wait, wait, it's not time yet? Well, now, my dear, it is. For there is something I must tell you, something which I've been meaning to write down for a long time. I've never told this story before to anyone other than your dear great-grandfather. I haven't wanted to, not really, you see. The romantic secret of it has burned too brightly in me. The dream thrilled in every pore of my skin. But now, I've got no more time left. I must tell my story, and I must tell it to you, dear Fiona, who is in love. Who will understand the dream. So bear with me, and come with me, into a place long ago and far away. Part 1. Beauty. Here the deities approve, the gods of music and of love. All the talents they have lent you, all the blessings they have sent you, pleased to see what they bestow, live and thrive so well below. From Welcome to All the Pleasures by Henry Purcell, 1659 to 1695. 1. Trumpets sound, bells ring, for today is Midsummer's Day and the day of a great feast at the castle of Bois Joli. Do you know the castle of Bois Joli? It lies some distance north of the great busy city of Paris, and a short distance from the ancient town of Senlis, where the first kings of France were crowned. It is a magnificent castle, built 2 centuries before the time of this story, of white stone, with silver turrets gleaming in the sun. There are walled gardens filled with orange and lemon trees, and knotted herb gardens, and a rose walk, which today is heavy with the smell of musky roses, and the buzzing of hundreds of bees. There are fountains playing their watery song to whoever will listen. And today, for this great occasion, the water has been dyed crimson and yellow and blue. There are long white gravelled walks bordered with bushes, cut in the shapes of animals and gods and nymphs and even trees. Along one walk is a line of marble statues representing the hunt. The mounted hunters with their bows and arrows and long horns, the eager dogs straining at the leash, the stag at bay, head turned, noble even in defeat, the hares running, the cunning fox with his triangular face. These statues were made in the time of the first building of the castle, and so 200 years of weather have lizarded the white marble with green and brown trails, which make the statues look enchanted. Creatures of the forest caught spellbound. For it is there that the woods, which give the area its name, used to be, lapping at the walls of the castle before they were pushed back by the woodcutter's axe. The woods have now, on this midsummer morning in 1771, retreated some distance to the slope that folds away from the castle. Every 10 days or so, all year round, a party sets out from the castle to go into the woods of Bois Joli, with picnic baskets laden with fruit and comfits, and little pastries and bottles of sweet wine. At the head of the party is the lovely Countess Amandine of Bois Joli, who goes to visit her aunts in the forest. She is mounted on a white horse. Her skirts are of silver damask and snowy lace. Her hair, with flowers and feathers in it, is powdered white as her lace, and her smile is joyful. Sometimes her husband, the Count Candide of Boisjoli, goes with her, sometimes not. Sometimes, too, she is accompanied by the coachman's wife, Finette, on her little brown gelding. Finette is a woodcutter's child, who grew up with deer and boar and foxes as her attendants, and who goes to visit her own parents. She is a childhood friend of the Countess, of the same age and of such similar looks that it amuses the Countess at times to pretend they are sisters. The Countess never misses her visits to her old aunts, who brought her up far from the eye of the world, in the vast, messy, crumbling cottage they kept as a home, though their blood was nobler and stranger than even the Count's. Never, that is, until a few weeks ago, when her first child was born. Finette was brought to bed at the same time, and each family celebrated the birth of their firstborn, both mewling, squalling, red-faced, gorgeous daughters. Today is another day when Amandine and Finette will not ride to the forest, for on this midsummer day in 1771, the forest will come to them instead. The old aunts and the woodcutters have been invited to a feast in honour of the grand christening of the small Lady Aurora of Boisjoli, and the rather humbler one of the little Clementine, daughter of Finette and her husband Melchior. It is a brilliant day of blue and gold richness and birdsong, as if nature herself were bringing gifts for the oblivious infant still sleeping, one in her beribboned cot of gold-painted and carved precious wood, the other in her simple, strong bed of pale oak wood, which Finette has decorated with coloured skeins of wool. Long lashes lie on pretty-skinned cheeks, bright kittenish eyes, one pair blue as the sky, the other blue as the sea, hidden and sleeping. Tiny hands lie softly on embroidered quilt and soft white blanket. Tiny chests rise and fall gently, while baby dreams chase around under soft, pale hair. But only the babies are quiet and peaceful. Everyone else is in a right bother. Count Candide is running around in great excitement, putting the finishing touches to his greatest invention so far, an entire orchestra of robot musicians. Amandine watches him for a while, smiling. "Do you like them?" he calls to her as he sweeps past, anxiously following a clumsy servant who has already put the wrong cog in the arm of one of the mechanical violinists. "Yes, my love, they are very wonderful," she says. And so they are. 20 of them, stiff as posts, in their metal and wooden finery, eyes fixed yet curiously lifelike, for they have been made in glass by a great craftsman. Each of them has an instrument on which it will play the one tune it has been programmed to perform. After that, it will be the turn of the human orchestra. Amandine does not say that the sight of these mechanical men in their tangle of metal limbs makes her shudder. Her husband loves all that is new, adores all the meddling possible by humans with their bright, busy brains. She too appreciates new things, but she has been brought up in the forest, amidst the wild magic and uncertain tempers of her aunts. It is altogether different. Sometimes Candide will sigh. "Oh, you were brought up in another time," he will say. "Fairy aunts belong to the past. We don't need magic anymore. We are conquering nature by ourselves, with science, with invention, with new ideas. One day we will be masters of the earth, the sea, the sky." "Will we?" says Amandine dutifully. Candide has ferments of ideas boiling in his skull, and not only to do with science. He is excited by the deeds of explorers and pores over new maps for hours. He is also interested in the new ideas about equality and brotherhood sweeping the salons of the capital and whispered in the halls of the court. Amandine listens and nods her head. She thinks about painting a picture of the forest rising like a green tide over the slope. Today, then, she watches for a while, then goes off to supervise her own arrangements, the little gifts beside each person's plate, the gorgeous centrepiece of roses and jewels, which will sit in the centre of the table. The hangings she has made herself and painted with scenes from mythology. So everything is going like one of those clockwork figures of her husband's, humming along on its cogs as the whole castle swings into action. In the stables, Melchior is talking to the horses. Each has been groomed to within an inch of its life. Some, like the Countess's white mare Joli, loved the experience. Others, like Finette's Olivant, hated it. There are many horses in the stables, but Joli and Olivant are the ones Melchior has known the best and longest, and so the ones he is most friendly with. Melchior listens to their talk and does not interrupt too often, for he has learnt over the years that horses can easily be offended by what they, maybe rightly, see as humans' overwhelming sense of self-importance.
"I have seen your little one. She is very pretty for a coachman's child," says Joli to Melchior in her pompous way.
Olivant looks at her and snorts. Joli tosses her head. She and Olivant are often at odds, though truth to tell, they have known each other for so long that they would pine away if one or the other were no longer there. Melchior does not take offence. He knows Joli means well. He smiles and says,
"Yes, she is lovely, isn't she?"
And so she is, he thinks. He is overwhelmed by love for her and for his beautiful, clever Finette. He still cannot quite believe that Finette consented to marry him. After all, despite the fact she is a woodcutter's daughter, she is the good friend of the Countess and able to call on her bounty. And Melchior, though he is handsome enough and a genius with horses, was thought somewhat simple because he spoke little in human company, preferring to speak with his charges instead. But Finette was not brought up in the woods for nothing. Not for nothing did she run wild with the forest animals. Even now she can call creatures to her and walks easily amongst them, setting broken bones, fixing illnesses, comforting distress. She saw a kindred spirit in Melchior, and they have been very happy. The Countess's affection for Finette granted them a lovely little house at the back of the castle, not very far from the woods, a house with a garden full of herbs and flowers, for Finette loves plants too, and can coax them to poke their sleepy heads above ground earlier than anyone else in the district.
"I suppose that in a few months we will be going to court to present the little Lady Aurora," says Joli, preening herself as she catches sight of her gleaming coat and flowing mane in a bucket of water.
Melchior sighs.
"I suppose we will," he says gloomily.
That is the only time he dislikes his life, on the infrequent occasions when he has to drive the Boisjoli coach to court. He has to be dressed in a stiff, hot coat, and his face must be painfully shaved very clean, his hair powdered stiffly, his sturdy legs encased in thick, prickly stockings, his mouth buttoned tight. No talking to the horses then, no looking like anything short of a statue, for the courtiers are notoriously bored and therefore gossipy and curious. If word got out of any of the irregularities of Boisjoli, there would be flocks of courtiers descending on them in a flurry of silks and satins and ribbons, swarming everywhere, taking notes, exclaiming, "How charming!" and generally acting as if they were in a human zoo. Fortunately, the Count and Countess dislike the court almost as much as Melchior does, and so the occasions are infrequent indeed. The Count has confided to him that the King is too preoccupied with his own affairs to be interested in them, but that there are indeed characters at court who would not be loath to have some new delicious entertainment.
"And I fear that my wife's poor aunts would be the first dish in their banquet of wonders," he had said. "Just imagine, Melchior, if they should take it into their heads to turn such and such a pop-eyed duke into a frog, or this or that lady into the praying mantis she so closely resembles."
Now Olivant flicks at a fly.
"I wonder if the oldest aunt is coming," he neighs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.